Ladies and gentlemen, why don't you have a seat? Let's get started. I'm very grateful to all of you for coming today. After all, it is, you know, Erev Chag, with people getting ready for Thanksgiving, as they say. And I was thinking to myself, you know, there's an old yeshiva joke, and you probably heard it. It's not really a joke, just kind of a witticism. You know, when the Jews first came to this country, they didn't know exactly what to make of the turkey. Because not to make the turkey out, you know, but they didn't know, is it a chicken? Is it kosher? What exactly is it? There are, in fact, some Jews today who won't even eat turkey because it doesn't conform to the traditional list. They ended up calling it, and the Hebrew term for turkey is tarnagol hodu, right? Literally the chicken of India. Hodu is India, and because these were called the Indies, right? They thought they were reaching Indians, they called it the chicken of India. But it just occurred to me, it's kind of funny, because it must mean that Thanksgiving is in the Torah, because the word hodu, you can vocalize as to mean they praise, they thank, right? So what is the chicken of thanking? So we see, therefore, okay. So anyways, here's the joke. That was not the joke, that was just a thought. The joke goes like this. Thank you. She thought she missed it. So the joke goes like this. They're having in Scotland the annual games to determine the greatest of the Scotsmen. And they have the beam throwing event, and they have the bagpipes, and of course they have the lumber cutting event. And they have all these lumberjacks from all around the world descending on these villages north of Edinburgh to determine who in fact is the greatest lumberjack ever. They have the French Canadians, and they have, you know, Scots, and they have Northern Germans, and everyone's there. And they're all trying to cut down these trees, and they have various levels of success. And finally, this little old Jew from Brooklyn, long black capota, a little bit bent over, looks like he weighs about 110 pounds. The axe looks like he weighs more than he does. And they don't want to let him compete. But he says, please, you know, you got to let me compete. I showed up all the way. So they say, all right, fine. And they point him out to one of these massive Scottish trees, like a big sequoia kind of tree. And he looks at it, and then he just takes one-handed mighty swing of his axe, and he slices it in half. And the judges are totally astounded. He completely beat out all of the Quebecois and all the Scots and so on. And they went out to him, and they said, that's amazing. How did you do that? Where did you learn to cut down trees like that? And he says to them, have you ever heard of the Sahara Forest? And they said, no. And he says, now it's a Sahara Desert. Okay, all right. Kind of lost it in the middle. Did you get that one, Estevelle? It wasn't so funny, but I'm actually a little bit sick today, so please forgive me. Give me a break. Okay, today we have an unusual topic. It's a topic of little relevance in the grand scope of Jewish history. It's kind of like an unusual 200 or 300 footnote, and Jewish history is so long that we can afford 200 or 300 years for a footnote. But it's an unusual event, or an unusual theme in medieval Jewish history that by its absence, by its lack of continuity with the rest of Jewish history, also indicates what are the dominant trends of Jewish history. In other words, the fact that this movement, the Hasidei Ashkenaz, were largely rejected by the main body politic of the Jewish people, indicates what Jewish people believe to be central to their faith, and what things were not central. So we'll look at this exception, which will help us prove the rule of the development of Judaism in the medieval period. Specifically, this group known as the Hasidei Ashkenaz were so-called German pietists. The word Hasid in Hebrew is associated most prominently today with the 18th century Hasidim, such as Chabad, Satmar, you know, and these various groups that are still very much alive today. And the word originally means pious, or someone who goes beyond the letter of the law, someone who does more than is expected. And a lot of examples we could use for this. The word goes back to the biblical period, obviously. David refers to himself in one passage in Tehillim as a chassid. And it's related to the word chesed, meaning kindness, and so on. Ashkenaz is, of course, Germany. So these group of Jews in 13th century Germany were known as the pious ones of Germany. but they're not at all related to the pious ones, the Hasidim of Poland in the 18th century. The only thing they share is the name Hasidim. So we should get that straight to begin with. They are an interesting and unusual movement, and we'll look a little bit later at the work of Rabbi Chaim Soloveitchik, Dr. Chaim Soloveitchik, a noted historian of Jewish topics, who separates three main groups. There is piety, there is the general idea of piety. There is pietism, which refers to a specific set of practices associated with piety. And then there is German pietism, which is the English translation of the Hasidei Ashkenaz movement that we're going to look at today. Where is Ashkenaz? It is, of course, Germany, but it's primarily the Upper Rhineland region, the towns of Speyer, Worms, and Mainz that have come up so often in the last 3 or 4 weeks. And also the city of Regensburg is quite significant as well as the center of this movement. We're going to look in particular at the work of perhaps the most prominent of the Hasidei Ashkenaz, a man known as Yehudah he-Hasid, whose approximate dates are about 1150 to 1217, the year of his death. His activity was principally in the town of Speyer in the Upper Rhineland, and then in Regensburg. In some cases, he's known as Yehudah of Regensburg rather than Yehudah the Hasid. And there are all kinds of legends and stories about him. He's very famous for an overwhelming degree of humility. We'll look at the ethical standards that he maintained in his life. And also a lot of miracles are associated with him. A lot of fantastic stories and legends and so on have grouped around his life. He is most well known because he left behind a significant literary legacy, big, thick, two-volume Sefer Hasidim, the Book of the Pious, which is a classic of 13th century thought. This is a brand new edition that just came out, critical edition with lots of commentary and so on. And I think we'll read about two-thirds of it today. I think we might go a little bit over the 1 hour, but no. Okay. He wrote several other works, Sefer HaKavod and so on, most of which are completely lost. But the thing that he is perhaps most known for is not this huge work, the Sefer Hasidim, which we will see is it's possible he didn't write most of it, actually. He's famous for his unusual will. He left behind a will, the tzava of Rabbi Yehudah he-Hasid, that was primarily intended for his students. And it has, it's not a typical will, it's an ethical will, it's a hortatory will in which he indicates to his children the kind of behaviors that he would like them to emulate in the future. It's not a will like, you know, I want Shloimi to have my baseball card collection, and Perla, you can have the, I don't know, my clothes, whatever. This is a will in which he instructs his children as how he wants them to behave. It's a genre of Hebrew literature that's really quite fascinating. We have hundreds of these wills that are written throughout the medieval period in which we get a sense of what Jews really valued and how they communicated it to their own children. I can share with you that in my own family, we have a custom. I have a daughter here who can testify to this. Testify, Will, get it? Okay. I'm definitely not feeling well. Where every year on Erev Yom Kippur, my wife and I give a distinct will to each one of our children. And it's a will, it's an ethical will like this, it's a tzavah, in which we tell them how much we love them, most of them anyways, and you know how the characteristics that we really are happy to see they have, and then we really stick it to them with the things we want them to change about themselves as soon as possible, or they won't get the keys to the car, that kind of thing. So it's really initiated a genre. Now I'll tell you one little hint as to where we're going to conclude tonight's lecture. It is in the will of Rabbi Yehudah he-Hasid, something which has become near universal in Jewish practice, Hasidim, Ashkenazim, Sephardim. It's hard to find a Jew who will not take this as one of the strictest laws in the Torah, never to marry a person with the same name as your parent. Okay? It's a very, you know, a parent. If a man marries a man with the same name as his father, we have probably more basic problems that need to be addressed. But so it's always going to be the opposite gender.
Mother's name.
Right. So a man cannot marry a woman with the same name as his mother, and a woman should not marry a man with the same name as his father. Yeah.
What if they add a name to it?
So that's what we do. Is, you know, the girl will take on a new name. She'll be Sarah Chaya, Miriam Basha, whatever. She'll add something to just change the name a little bit. So it's not exactly the same name, Nishka Ferlach. But nevertheless, it is. It comes from the Tzava of Rabbeinu Yehudah he-Hasid. It's no other source anywhere in the Torah. It just appears by magic, and there's a lot of other things in there that we'll talk about at the end of tonight's class. Okay, so why don't we go on a little bit? My voice is failing me, so I may speak a little faster. We'll see how we go through things today. Rabbi Yehudah he-Hasid came from a very distinguished family background, the Kalonymous family, well known in particular for their work on Kabbalah and specifically in the Hasidei Ashkenaz movement. According to legend, this family came originally from Italy with Charlemagne to central Germany, and that would have given them about 200 or 300 years of history in Germany before we get to the period of Yehudah he-Hasid. Their work, especially when they committed it to writing, and we have quite a few examples of these, heavily influenced by the biblical commentator Abraham ibn Ezra, who we haven't studied much about him, but he's a rough contemporary of Rashi's, and a very, very profound and moving biblical commentary that places equal emphasis on painstaking attention to grammar, to make sure we understand the verses correctly, and a somewhat pessimistic worldview. He tends to have a very dark and cynical view of the world. He lived himself in great poverty, wandering from place to place. It is a work of surpassing beauty, however, and it had a very significant influence on the Kalonymous family, many of whom authored works that showed themselves as intellectual heirs to Ibn Ezra. The family and students, most of these people all authored works of relevance. Shmuel ben Kalonymous he-Hasid, and then his son, of course, is the one we're focusing on, Yehudah he-Hasid. The term he-Hasid is, of course, not a surname. It is a honorific. It means the pious one. So Yehudah, the pious one. There are very few people in Jewish history who get that honorific. Who else gets the honorific he-Hasid, the pious one? The only person I can think of is Shmuel.
Is it Vilna Gaon?
The Vilna Gaon. No, they don't. They do call in the frontispiece to many of his books does say, you know, Eliyahu ben, I forget his father's name, Hagaon he-Hasid. They call him the Gaon, the pride, and the Hasid. But as an honorific like this, you don't see it all that often. Okay, maybe I'll think of one later. Moshe Hadarshan Eliezer and Moshe ben Eliezer. So he's got like 4 or 5 generations of literary greatness, and these are really the core members of the Hasidei Ashkenaz. Several other really important disciples, the author of the Arugas Habosem, and a very important early halachic source, the Or Zarua, Yitzchak ben Moshe. They all fall within this group, the Hasidei Ashkenaz. If you're not really conversant with all of these major names, it won't mean anything, but if you do study much halacha, many of these names come up quite frequently. The region, as I mentioned earlier, is here in the Upper Rhineland, central Germany. These are the 3 towns, Speyer, Worms, and Mainz here. Regensburg, just a little bit to the east. Excuse me. This rather confusing map just gives you a sense of where the Ashkenazim moved. I don't really like the arrows because it tends to imply that the size of the migration was different. But the reality is that many of these Jews, the bulk of them, moved to Eastern Europe, which really vastly outnumbered the central Rhineland region by the 19th century. And then you have not so much from Germany. You have a small migration in the 1840s from Germany, but a much larger migration from the former Russian Empire in the late 19th century. So just ignore the arrows, but you get a sense of where these Jews moved from central Germany into Eastern Europe, and then later many of them off to America, some down as well to Israel, and so on. Okay, so the Hasidei Ashkenaz, among the many things that are interesting about this movement is they are very, very heavily influenced by the Christian world as well. This is a general principle in Jewish history. It's absolutely clear, without a shadow of a doubt, that Jews living as minorities are heavily influenced by the societies in which they live. Sometimes it is reactionary, but quite often it is one of Jews will assimilate into their practice things that they absorb from the outside world. There's an expression in Yiddish, I'm sure many of you heard it, as es chriselt sich, es yiddelt sich. As the Christians behave, the Jews also behave. In Yiddish it means to, you know, chriselt sich means to Christianize yourself, so the Jews also Judaize themselves. They also absorb what the Christians are doing and incorporate into them. That's no longer true today, of course. We don't have anything like, you've probably never seen something like a Hanukkah bush, for example.
Oh, of course.
That's a joke, right? Okay. Okay, yeah, thank you, Ms. Herman. I appreciate that. But it's, I'll remember that for the participation grade, right? But the, you know, it's very common that we will absorb things from the outside world. Sometimes, you know, we can even transform things. There are, you know, a certain number of very much beloved cantorial tunes that really date to like mid-18th century German drinking songs, for example. You know, Jews on Shabbos walking past the Brauhaus and they hear the Germans in there singing these songs and they say, you know, that would sound really good for Musaf. And it sort of gets incorporated into Musaf and maybe they forget the German drinking song, but we keep it in Musaf and so on. So these things happen. So there's clearly among the Hasidei Ashkenaz some strong trends of Christian pietist movements, meaning the tenor of the age was one in which self-mortification, self-flagellation, self-abnegation were very popular among Christians, and the Hasidei Ashkenaz also absorbed many of those ideas. The idea that, for example, we are fundamentally evil, the strong influence of the notion of original sin, a Christian notion of original sin, the strong notion of the role of Satan in the world, a distinctly Christian notion in which Satan is an overpowering and evil entity rebelling against God at every turn, and people can be, you know, allied to his negative cause and so on. These have very shallow roots in Judaism, but in Hasidim of Ashkenaz, they found fertile soil, and so many of these ideas are well represented in the group. Also, at this time, we should remember that the Hasidei Ashkenaz had just a century before gone through the trauma of the Crusades, which we've spoken about in a couple of classes now. But this was really like, for the Ashkenazim, it's comparable to the way the Sephardim felt about the expulsion, the way, in many ways, the Jews of the late 20th century felt about the Holocaust even. There are very strong parallels there because it represented such a huge break from the traditions of the past, such a huge rift in the fundamental belief in the justness of society and so on. And so this kind of internal negativity, this pessimism, combined with the idea that, you know, we have to rectify our sins through flagellation or through other kinds of penance, you see very much in the movement of the Hasidei Ashkenaz. Sorcery and witchcraft also goes with the idea of the role of Satan. All these things come together in this strange movement. Yes?
Those type of things are, I guess, a terminology in the Darkei Amori, right?
Yes.
So, I mean, it was really a violation of halacha, you know, to do those things. It's not just a matter of, well, you know, it's a custom of this or that. So, I mean, did the rabbinical leaders at that time try to prevent it or slow it down?
Oh, that's an excellent question. If I can, I'll rephrase it. Okay. There is a prohibition in Judaism, a very strong prohibition, to not go in the ways of the Gentiles. Sometimes it's called Darkei Amore, which means the paths of the Amorites, or Chukas HaGoyim, the decrees of the non-Jews. And we're not supposed to imitate non-Jews. It's a very basic rule. However, you can only measure that when it comes to actual practice. Like, for example, that the code of Jewish law describes the wearing of a certain color shoelace on a particular day as Darche Amore. Or you might want to say wearing green on St. Patrick's Day. You know, no offense if you like to do that. But maybe that's a non-Jewish custom, wearing green on St. Patrick's Day, especially because it's St. Patrick, right? That sounds sort of religious. So that might be in the category of a belief, a practice that can be measured, that the rabbis can legislate against. But when it comes to the realm of ideas, of ways of thinking, it's very hard to say that thinking this way is outright prohibited. In general, in my limited understanding of Judaism, there's very few prohibitions on how to think. Lots on how to behave, but very few on how to think. So in other words, if you want to say that, you know, we're being punished for our sins, think of the Crusades that happened just a couple generations ago, we're being punished for our sins, and we have to do penance for our sins, we have to atone for them. The way we atone for them is through, for example, repeated fasts. Then that's what we should be doing. It happens that the Christians are also fasting a lot. We're not actually imitating them, we're just thinking it through ourselves.
But I think like flagellation, isn't that against...
I think you could make a good argument for it, but giving makas actually persisted right up into the 19th century. You know, it happens even in domestic circumstances even today. Well, no, I shouldn't say that. I should get off that.
But what about the witchcraft and the sorcery? That's already...
Oh, no, that, not that we were practicing it, but a belief that there is witchcraft. Well, we invented that, right? We have that already in the Torah, that you should not allow a witch to live, things like that. That has very, very old roots in Judaism. It's just that for the most part, we ignored it because, you know, it didn't seem very relevant. You won't find many 10th century, 9th century sources talking about, you know, witches and the worry about... Well, actually, maybe I take it back. The idea of the Ayin Hara, very big in the Talmud. You see that, you know, quite a bit through here. But the Hasidei Ashkenaz obviously, it's much richer in their literature than in most of the other strands of Jewish literature. Yes, Mr. Lack.
Even today, Erev Yom Kippur, some Hasidim simulate Makkos.
Exactly. Yeah, and it's the same idea. You know, I think where the prohibition would be is causing yourself to bleed, an actual wound, because that's a measurement. But you know, making yourself uncomfortable, you know, we're good at that.
We do that a lot.
Yes.
Jewish people. I understand that we copied from the Christian Rabbi Gershon issue about having more than one wife from the Christians.
Well, I don't know if I would be comfortable saying he copied the Christians.
Two things. One, that he had too many wives and they gave him sorrows.
Yeah.
And the other one is from the Christians.
So there's lots of... I think there's a lot of ways to approach that question. But there's no... I would agree that Rabbeinu Gershom Meir HaGola said, you know what, we're living in a monogamous society. It's very difficult for us to maintain polygamy in a society in which it's frowned upon. And then his ban could have come from there. It's not so much... I think is imitating the Christians as saying it's very uncomfortable and difficult for business and economic reasons as well.
A good thought anyhow.
Yeah, I think I agree. Yes.
One is sorus, two is food.
Okay, Ms. Abramson, then we're going to go on.
In the generation that he made the ban, did the people who were already in polygamous marriages have to divorce their wives?
That's a good question. The question from the back of the house is, when Rabbeinu, the answer I have to tell you is I don't know. But the question is, when Rabbeinu Gershom Meir HaGola made the ban on polygamy, did he grandfather in all those existing polygamous relationships? And I simply don't know. Yeah, probably would. I'd be hard to...
I'm studying about the Git Meganes, my rabbi.
Oh, very good. Okay, yes, last question, really last question.
You know, you say with the witchcraft and so forth and so on, it's very much frowned upon, to say the least. But when people go ahead and shluck kapuras with a chicken, isn't that transferring your sins into that poor chicken?
Yeah, well, exactly.
Isn't that sort of the same thing?
That's a great question. I'm going to dodge it right now because it fits in a little better when we talk about something else in Sefer Hasidim. So hang on to it. We'll come back to it.
No problem.
Okay, so what do they have in their literature? What's so special about the literature of this movement? Two main themes. One is a strong... ethical tendency. They write a lot of moralistic works, like Sefer Hasidim, at least the first half of Sefer Hasidim, which show a very strong emphasis of Maimonidean thought. Maimonides' classic formulation of morality is one which he adapted from Aristotle, which basically says that for every character trait, for every midah, there is an excess and there is a deficiency. So for example, I think we may have talked about this last year when we talked about Maimonides, there is the attribute or character trait of courage. And it's possible, for example, to have too much courage, an excess, like most 15-year-old males, for example, way too much courage. They're all, you know, they're crazy to do stupid things because they have not moderated the too much courage they have. And on the other hand, you can have too little, a deficiency, which we call cowardice, where you're afraid to take even the smallest risk. So true courage, for the Rambam, is the Shvil HaZahav, the golden mean, the golden middle, which is like somehow balanced between those things. And so on with every kind of character trait, with love, with mercy, with hatred, with cruelty. There are all kinds of ways in which you find the golden mean. Very, very strong influence in the thought of the Hasidei Ashkenaz, borrowing straight from Rambam, and that follows through into, among other books, the Orchos Tzadikim borrows from the Hasidei Ashkenaz, who borrow from Maimonides, who in turn adapted Aristotle. That's one strong trend in the literature. The second trend is Kabbalistic literature, which goes very much along with the, you know, the richness of the spiritual world. And when I say sorcery and witchcraft, it's not promoting sorcery and witchcraft. It's rather more affirming that there is a supernatural world that we live in, and there are a lot of legitimate Jewish sources that support this idea. And there's in the Hasidic literature of the time, a lot of discussions of people coming back from the dead in dreams, or reincarnated as animals, or all kinds of like Jaini Loki, which are like local spirits, all kinds of things like that, which are very profound in the Hasidei Ashkenaz movement. It just reminded me for a second, I had a fleeting thought, and I was saying, remember that thought, because it's a good point, and I forgot it. Okay, so they use Sa'ad Yagon very heavily. However, they didn't read Arabic. These are Ashkenazim. They're reading in Yiddish and in Hebrew. And the translation they had of Sa'ad Yagon was not the famous Ibn Tibbon translation, but one that was quite a bit more flowery. And although I think Sa'ad Yagon would be personally offended to be called a mystic, a Kabbalist, it was possible to read in this very flower translation, kind of mystical bent. So they sort of changed Sa'ad Yagon's ideas as the basis of their Kabbalah. Okay, it was probably something to do with spirits and dreams and things like that. Oh well. In terms of the ethical literature, the Hasidei Ashkenaz believed that there were two main standards that a Jew had to be concerned with. The one was the so-called law of the Torah, and the other was the far more stringent law of heaven. And in this regard, they are borrowing from standards that are set in the Torah. There is such a concept, you see it especially in the Talmud, that you can be Yotze Bidei Bnei Adam, which means you can fulfill your obligation to human beings, or you can be Yotze Bidei Shamayim. You can be, you fulfill your obligation to God. So I'll give you an example from Bava Metzia, one tractate of the Talmud. let's say a man is a thief, and he steals $100 from somebody. And then after some time goes by, he decides he wants to make amends, he wants to do tshuva, and he wants to go into Yom Kippur clean of his sin. So there are two things that are required. First, he has to go through his own process of teshuva, which involves confession and abandoning the sin and so on. And the second thing is, he has to pay back the money. Right, until you,
the first thing should be done.
Maybe the first thing should be pay back the money. But okay, so he has to pay back the money. You can't do tshuva completely. You can't get kapara unless you right the wrong. See, the problem is though, there were five people he could have stolen from, and he does not remember which one he stole from. So the Gemara says he brings all five people together, and he says, listen, I'm really sorry. Back in 1956, I stole $100 from one of you guys, and I want to return it right now. And the, each of the five guys says, it was me, right? My, so now here he's stuck. He's got $100 to give back, but he does, still doesn't know which one to give it to because each one of the five guys says, gave for me. So the halacha, which is the baseline, is what he can do is he can put the $100 on the table and he say, here, and then just walk away. And they'll fight over it. And, you know, maybe the right guy will get the money back. And he will be Yotze B'yadei Adam. He will have fulfilled the baseline requirement of paying back his debt. However, says Rabbi Akiva, that's really not good enough. A person should try to be Yotze B'yadei Shamayim. Fulfill your obligation vis-a-vis heaven. And what he should do is he should take out $500 and give each one of them $100. Huh. So this teaches you one very important thing.
Never say in front of five, say in front of one.
I was going to say, keep accurate records. You know, you got to remember who you steal from, because otherwise it's going to be very difficult to give back the money. So this is the kind of idea that's reinforced in the Hasidei Ashkenaz, that, okay, there's a bottom line standard that every Jew has to uphold, but we're striving for a much higher standard in which we're trying to like be completely exempt from even the slightest tinge of wrongdoing. In fact, the Talmud says, very close to that same passage, that the temple was destroyed because people observed the Torah. And the rabbis say, what are you talking about? The temple was destroyed because they observed the Torah? And the Talmud clarifies, yes, it was destroyed because people only observed the Torah. They walked around and said, okay, what's the minimum I need to do to fulfill my obligation, and that's all I want to do. Nobody would step beyond the line and spend a little more money to be righteous. Okay. Yes, I'm sorry.
I was just going to say that four of those men were thieves.
Exactly.
So why would they have to give the $500?
Because he doesn't know. You're right, four of those guys are thieves. But nevertheless, he's going to give $500 because he'd rather give away the money than make it possible that the person he stole from would not get repaid. And that's a much higher standard. So keep good records, because otherwise you'd be in trouble. Yes?
The first Mishnah in Baba Metzia is different.
So the first Mishnah is the two it's guys struggling over a talus.
It's the wrong solution.
The fact is, actually, one of the things that the Talmud would discuss is, hey, why isn't this like the case in the first Mishnah in Baba Metzia? And if you're familiar with the Tosfos there, there's even a better example with the boat that's moored in the middle of the lake. And nobody knows whose it is. And so the Talmud says, just kol dalin gvar. This is, you know, what we do in Talmud study. Lots of discussions of these multiple things. And I don't think I'm really qualified to talk about it now. So let's go on. By the way, I like this picture of Charlton Heston here. Yeah, I hope you enjoy it. I like it because a lot of my students say I have a striking resemblance.
Is he that old?
You know, right.
I've been sitting here trying to figure out what it is with my eyesight, and I kept looking.
We need to turn out the lights to see Charlton Heston with that. Okay, now here's something that is, so that element of the thought of the Hasidei Ashkenaz has very strong roots in the Jewish tradition and so on, many Talmudic stories. There is another element, however, which the Hasidei Ashkenaz reveled in, and it had a significant impact for quite some time, even to the present day, this idea of what's called Tshuvat HaMishkal, translated perhaps as commensurate repentance, or more literally, the repentance of weighing. Now, what is Tshuvat HaMishkal? It's a, it is a way of doing teshuvah, of repenting, that tries to take in the totality of the impact that your wrongdoing had on the world, and repenting for all of it, which is a very high standard. Like in the example I gave, so let's say you stole $100 from one in five people, and then you you gave back $500, so certainly on a monetary level, you have paid back your money. However, with that $100 that you stole, think about what really went on. First of all, there's the anguish that the person who lost the money felt. Maybe that money would have gone to, let's say, pay the tutors for the children of that man who lost the money. And as a result, those children missed out on some lessons. And as a result, they fell behind in classes. And as a result, they maybe were not able to get as high quality a match later on in life. And as a result, and it can go on and on and on, with the ramifications of what that person suffered as a result of losing the $100. And from your perspective, you got the $100, what did you get from it? So because of this, you paid the tutors to teach your children not to steal, and your children got the better shidduch, and your children, you know, went on into business and made more money, and they were better fed, and all kinds of things like this as a result of it. So tshuvat hamishkal means you try to calculate all of the ramifications of that wrongdoing, and you do tshuva for the whole thing, which is much, much harder than just measuring in terms of $100 in and out. Even if you want to adjust it for inflation, it's a lot harder. So for example, if I were to eat a cheeseburger, and then I were to repent of it, then I have to say, oh my gosh, so I ate a cheeseburger, so the cheeseburger weighed a quarter pound, let's say. I think they call them that, quarter pounders, right? And that means I derived one quarter pound of forbidden energy. With that quarter pound of forbidden energy, I went to work and I used that energy for, let's say, 3 hours of work, for which I was paid, I don't know, $75 or $100 worth, whatever I get paid an hour. And then because of that energy, I had more time to breathe and enjoy life and so on. I put all that stuff together, and then when I do teshuva for eating that cheeseburger, it's a much bigger deal. It's a lot more to pay for. And I can't pay money, I can't give a donation to heaven. The only thing I can do is I can take it out of my own hide. If I got a quarter pound worth of energy, I have to fast and lose a quarter pound. This would be a very popular kind of Teshuvah Watchers program, maybe, you know, Weight Watchers for Judaism. But I would have to fast, or I would have to flagellate myself, or I would have to endure some other kind of pain in order to, alleviate the energy that I had gained through the Teshuvah. And it would include things like the self-mortification rituals or self-abnegation rituals, all kinds of things that are far more than are normally required. In the edition of Orchos Tzedikim that we have in the back here, actually, it's the common translation, which, since it's influenced by, it is in Orchos Tzedikim, and it's also in, by the way, Mesilat Yesharim, an 18th century work, there's a discussion of how to do this, and there's actually a warning printed at the back of the book by Rabbi Moshe Feinstein, saying, kids, don't try this at home. This is really, you know, you can mess yourself up by thinking of your sins this way, and it's only for people at an extremely high level to actually consider doing it. But it was a deep occupation of the Hasidei Ashkenaz, this very strong emphasis on rituals of self-mortification. One last detail, and I see your question. The Hasidei Ashkenaz also believed that many of these atonements could be effected after death. So, especially in association with the Tahara process, the ritual rituals associated with burial, the Hasidei Ashkenaz would say things like, for example, I want my body placed in the coffin, and then I want it dragged through the streets to my grave. Meaning that the dragging, the suffering that my body endured, and the humiliation that it endured through that ritual should help to atone for all the sins I did in my life. And a lot of like really kind of nasty, even after death rituals that the Hasidim asked. There are some very interesting teshuvos written where...
I'm sorry? The Rabbein from the time I read that?
Well, at this time, yes. later on, there's some interesting questions where I believe I saw one teshuva that went, maybe it was the Bnei Yehoshua who answered this, but there was someone who asked for this kind of thing after death, that he wanted his body to be like dropped on the floor when in the Tahara process. And the Bnei Yehoshua, if I remember correctly, I have to look it up, he instructed the Chevra Kadisha not to do it, to ignore that request.
But they do that all the time.
Well, not on purpose.
Chevra Kadisha picks up the mess from the hospital bed, places them on the floor.
Oh, placing them on the floor. You know, that's right. They do that. They actually put the body on the floor temporarily, sometimes candles around the body. I never thought of that, but that's probably coming from this ritual. That's a very brilliant observation.
I think it's something else.
Yes.
In the village where I was born, yeah, they had a custom of placing the corpse on the floor.
Yeah.
It was a wooden floor. You won't believe this.
I'm ready.
You take a large wooden nail, put it next to the head, and bang it into the wooden floor, and holler out, Malchum of us gates the
Kinderedran. Wow. The angel of death. Go back to
to hell.
Wow, go to hell. Wow, that's amazing. That I've never seen a Chevra Kadisha do that. But today, most people now, if they pass away in hospitals, and it's a totally different thing. When the Chevra Kadisha gets the mace, they're already wrapped up in the sheets and so on.
But in today's Ashkenaz life, the Davni is much more lenient than the Arizal or the Sefar. We are much more quicker.
And the speed of davening.
The speed and the tochen and the
contents.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Okay. We don't have vidui like you people got vidui. I have to say vidui today.
I have vidui, yeah. Okay, Ms. Abramson, sorry.
Isn't this all kind of disrespectful to the Torah? Because they're basically saying that they know better than the Beis Din how big their punishment should be and how much they should receive punishment from, because Hashem isn't punishing them that much. So they're just deciding to harm the body that God gave them instead of just receiving the punishment either God designated for them through the Torah, aka the Beis Din,
You're asking a great question.
She's right.
And I think this is really taking us to what happens later. We should remember what ends up happening is most Jews, although they observe this with some interest and there are some elements that carry over, for the most part nobody else picks this up. You'll recall I began this lecture by saying it's kind of a footnote to Jewish history, so their impact was not felt in the area of self-mortification. I think it would be hard to say it's forbidden in the Torah to, you know, fast or to, you know, to whip yourself lightly without causing bruises, but it's talking not really Jewish.
That's
is what most people said.
They do today.
Yeah, right. When they cause themselves to bleed and the karbala and all that.
Is it just the Iranians? I think it goes beyond that.
All right, Judith, and then I think we should go on.
I was just going to bring up that fact that there is the Torah prohibition with the Nazarene.
Uh-huh.
That you never take anything to the extreme, and you don't cut yourself. And that's the whole thing, is that you don't cut yourself.
You're not allowed to cause a bruising. You're not allowed to harm yourself in any measurable way.
And so the most extreme would be to be in the Nazarene, and that too has its very defined limitations within the Torah. And I had one other. The area that they were concentrated in northern Germany, was that on... Was that on a major trade route?
Yes, and it was also, you know, it was the river, the Rhine River in particular.
So it was on the Rhine River. I couldn't see from the map because otherwise one of the things of its becoming a footnote would have been its isolation if that was the case, but it's not. Okay,
no.
Thank you.
Professor?
Last one, I'll bring more. Yes, go ahead.
Did we have that type of, in the time of the Ishmaelites, where we find the scrolls? What's the name of that sect that we find the
Pharisees?
So I'm not sure what your question is. I'm sorry.
Essenes.
Oh, the Dead Sea Scrolls, right? Sure. Well,
they weren't like this extreme.
They were
going,
also
going
extreme.
Of,
yeah, they were ascetic. They also believed in celibacy, mm-hmm. so they had to do recruitment drives every so often. Yeah.
They were celibacy.
Yeah. These guys were not into celibacy. They didn't go that far. So let's look at Sefer Hasidim for a few minutes, okay? This is the big book I brought here. Now, it's traditionally considered to be a work of Yehudah he-Hasid as the sole author, but scholarship from the last century has pretty conclusively demonstrated that it's the work of multiple authors, at least two. Perhaps Rabbi Yehudah he-Hasid's father, Shmuel, and perhaps a disciple, Eliezer of Worms. But there's internal contradictions in the text. For example, in one place there's a very strong prohibition against spells, which would be in the first part. And later on there's lots of discussions of using spells without that strong condemnation. In one part there's no mention whatsoever of gematria, right, numerology. And in the second section, hundreds of references to numerology and its internal effect. The language, the diction, the syntax, all very different between the sections. So most scholars today conclude it's really two books, almost completely divided in half. If you look at this edition, which is not published by a university press, but by a traditional religious publisher, it's almost exactly in half. It's just one actual paragraph is on the wrong side, according to what the scholars say. Now, when we compare, what also makes this more difficult is the fact that we have multiple copies of the original manuscripts. It was copied over many, many times, and we have today extant many copies with really thousands of variant readings. So trying to compare all these multiple copies and determine what's the authentic reading and then how many authors are there has been a bit of a mess. But for sure we can identify two principal groups of authors. One was most likely Yehudah he-Hasid writing the first part, and the second part perhaps one of the disciples or even his father. In this context, we see a huge divide between what is the context of both of those sections. The first section, which goes up to section 152, is your basic Maimonidean ethical treatise. No discussion of gematria, no real emphasis on asceticism. In fact, at one point it says that a person should not fast more than one day a month. There's nothing in the Torah that says you're not allowed to fast. In fact, under certain circumstances, you're supposed to fast even on Shabbat. But the first half of Sefer Hasidim says one day a month is taka, more is enough for everybody. The second section, however, is very different. Second section has all kinds of discussions of demonology, of shadim, of various types of supernatural beings, their noxious impact on the world, how to manipulate them, how to avoid them, where they hang out, all kinds of discussions of really folk beliefs. I don't want to use the word superstition, that's a little strong perhaps, but folk beliefs that are not really present in the first part, which is much more rationalistic kind of work. A lot of stories about miracles, and a very, very deep reflection of specific incidents in German Jewish life. So it feels very different as a work. There are all kinds of descriptions of it happened to a certain family in Regensburg, this certain thing happened, and this demon showed up, and they got this rabbi, and this rabbi said this, and he took care of the demon. Feels like a totally different work than the first part of Sefer Hasidim. And it reflects really the two main ideas that are extant at the same time within this movement. The high level of piety in the sense of ethical imperatives, and at the same time, this belief in the rich supernatural world and the impact of demons and things like that at the same time.
Can you put a timeline on more or less the two different?
Well, we don't know exactly. They definitely come within, let's say, two centuries. Let's say from 1050, 1150 to maybe 1300. That's pretty much it. Yeah.
There was a big theater movie about the Dibbuk.
Right, the Dibbuk has lots of stuff in here as well. The possession, right? Demonic possession is in there. What probably happened is it had a great title, Sefer Hasidim, the Book of the Pious, and other people would just glom extra things onto it, like addenda, appendices, perhaps a big chunk from one author, that kind of thing. That creates the much larger work that we have today. So Rabbi Soloveitchik, shown here, is one of the principal scholars who's worked on this in recent times. And what he remarks on is that the second half, the part that really focuses on the magical world and things and the asceticism as well, he says it has little to no cultural resonance. As I think we've explored in our own discussion here, it's very difficult for us in the 21st century to identify with a lot of the things that are going on with the self-flagellation and things like that. It takes a break, stretch of the imagination. It just didn't stick. It didn't work for Jews. They looked at it, they said, wow, that's really weird. Those Germans, those Ashkenazim, I don't know what to make of them. Yes. And then they just left it behind. And they, as it were, that's what makes it a footnote in Jewish history, that that element of self-flagellation just kind of stayed in the 13th century and did not move further. One significant exception, however, is this idea of the Tshuvat HaMishkal, the commensurate repentance, which perhaps because of its internal logic of the quote-unquote wages of sin, the idea of the ramification of transgression, that did take hold in the literary tradition, and we have it certainly up. My last reference would be from the Mesilat Yesharim, in which it is actually a chapter in the Mesilat Yesharim, a very important 18th century work, and that's the only element that really stuck hold. Yes, I'm sorry, I cut you off.
I'm sorry, don't I
interrupt you? No, please.
At that time, the Christian religion was at the same step, and it continued further on. And I have to say, me being born in Mexico City, the flagellation between the bias of there is still going on. But if we take both religions or both ways of life, there was kind of a mystical way of living. Sometimes was the inner, you know, your nerves, your not knowing situations that makes you
a little bit
in what you have to do.
Yeah.
But it was parallel with the coin at that time. It was very parallel.
I think
it was
that's
not different.
That's a very valid observation. And I think that maybe the way we can imagine this is that, you know, for a while, Jewish religious thought and Christian religious thought intersected and perhaps borrowed some tradition from each other. But after 150, 200 years, the Jews kind of said, well, enough of this stuff, and went off on our own way. But you still see strong elements of the self-flagellation in the Christian faith up to the day. I would hazard a guess, particularly in Catholicism, but it's outside my area of expertise. Okay, so let's go now to the last part. So the will of Rabbeinu Yehudah he-Hasid. This is a really fun document. It's in the first volume, and it's right at the beginning here. It's 78 specific demands that he makes of his sons. And it's not clear if he intended these 78 demands to be, why don't I see it right here? It's not clear if he intended these demands to be only for his children and their descendants, or if he was writing a document that was for the world at large. It can easily be read as something personal. Like, for example, when he says to his sons, whatever you do, don't marry a woman with the same name as your mother. And you know why? Because I married your mother. And I know anyone married to a person named whatever. Okay, I thought that was funny, but it didn't go over so well. But it could be that he meant it specifically like that. We simply don't know. We only have the document. It is, however, a fascinating document because it's not only about, you know, how he hopes they will behave in business. There's all kinds of fascinating discussions. It starts with burial. You know, in other words, he's writing this before his death, presumably or not too far before his death, and he has a lot of discussions of how he wants to be buried. And while he's talking about that, he says, listen, there's some other things you should know about burial. For example, never bury two enemies next to each other, right? That's just, it's not, it makes sense. But, you know, why does it make sense?
Yeah.
Obviously, only if you have this larger spiritual imagination of these, the spirits of the deceased fighting with one another. He also has some very difficult situations, like, and it sounds like a very strong folk belief, like, for example, never a man who kisses his deceased son will bury his other children.
Really?
You know, really scary kind of things like that. You know, terrifying stuff. we don't necessarily want to hold with them. Then he goes on to marriage and happier topics, and there's a lot more here about marriage than just about not marrying a woman with the same name as your wife. Let me see if I can pick one just off the top of my head here. A person should not pull on his shoes on the day that he has the intention to go on the road. So what does that mean? I don't know. A person should not sit in a wagon that is standing in a boat. Right? Like if you know, like if you're in a like if you're in a ferry, I guess, and you drive onto the ferry, you know, get out of your car. Right? That's what he's saying here. A person should not slaughter geese in the month of Shvat, and there are those families who forbid it also in the month of Tevet, but really Shvat is the important month, right? Like weird things are in this. It's fascinating.
Does he give any sources?
I'm sorry?
He said something about not getting a haircut from
Shodesh. I don't remember that one. I just reviewed it the other day.
There are no explanations.
No, it's no sources, nothing. He's just saying the geese. Geese, it says masculine, but it's plural, so it could be female too. A person should not write on his book, "This is my book." Rather, he should write just his name. In other words, I put my name in here, and thank God, I wasn't thinking, but I just wrote, you know, Henry Abramson, Hillel Abramson, and that's it. I should not write, "This is my book." Right? Don't do that. So now, why does he say that? I don't know. Here it is. Look at this. A person should not get a haircut nor trim his beard on Rosh Chodesh. And similarly, should not cut his nails on Rosh Chodesh.
He also mentions Moshe Shabbos.
Is there any logic behind all this? Or just any logic behind all this?
Some things I think would have logic, but a lot of them just seem to like fall out of the sky. And there's no sources whatsoever and no discussion. No. So that's where we get the... But nevertheless, you know, never marry a woman with the same name as your mother because it's in the same category. So I want to tell the last... This is the last joke part. This is the part that I think is funny. Shown here is the grave of the incomparable Kutzker Rebbe. Now, the Kutzker, a 19th century Hasidic rabbi, a brilliant and absolutely devastating wit. He was especially good at cutting down people who thought, you know, more of themselves than they deserved. And just thinking about the Kutzker, I have to adjust my tie because it's really someone special. So the Kutzker once said about this will of Rabbeinu Yehudah he-Hasid. And as we said, there's all kinds of weird things in here. Don't sit on the wagon when it's on top of the boat and things like that. No sources whatsoever. And yet people hold to it like it's Torah Misinai, that it is like, you know, the holiest of holy. So what the Kutzker once said is that if Yehudah he-Hasid had known how seriously people would read his will, he would have included the Ten Commandments in there. Okay, so with that, let's just think about his legacy and we'll conclude for the day. Summarizing, the bifurcate nature of Sefer Hasidim is complex, right? There are two basic trends in the literature as a whole, seen especially in the work of Sefer Hasidim. The traditional pietism, right, the idea of the, the ethical demands, the higher standards, humility, things like that, popular, stayed in the Jewish tradition. It has earlier sources, but it continued on through afterwards. The self-mortification elements, however, did not make it through. The self-mortification elements simply got dropped by the Jewish body politic, didn't have a lot of staying power. But the work as a whole gives us an absolutely fascinating glimpse into the rich spiritual world of German Jewry. Thank you very much for your attention and your patience.